morning. Today I will talk about the fetal period and the fetal membranes. I will talk about the length of the fetus, the duration of pregnancy, the changes in the fetal period or the major changes in the fetal period, abnormal fetal growth, and the fetal membranes. Just reminding you that the fetal period is the period which extends from week 9 till birth. And this period is characterized by two events: maturation of the organs, okay, and rapid growth in length and weight. Start by the length of the fetus. We have two types. We have crown rump length, okay, or sitting height, okay, from the vertex to the breech, okay, from the vertex to the breech, it is the crown rump length. The other one is the crown heel length or standing height. Okay, crown heel length or standing height from the vertex to the heel. And the full term fetus is about 50 centimeters in length. Then duration of pregnancy. We have two methods for measuring the duration of pregnancy. Okay, two methods. First one from the date of last menstruation, and the other one from the date of fertilization. Actually, date of last menstruation is physically known. That's why this is the date, okay, which is used to measure the date of delivery. Okay, the duration of pregnancy from the date of last menstruation is 40 weeks. The duration of pregnancy from the date of fertilization is 2 weeks less, so 38 weeks. Then calculation of the date of delivery. Okay, date of last menstruation plus 9 months and 7 days, okay, or plus 40 weeks. If the date of last menstruation 16 January 2018, then we add how many days? We add 7 days, we add 9 months, and the result is the date of birth or date of delivery is 23, okay, October, okay, 2018. And that is actually today. Then what are the major changes in the fetal period? Okay, maturation of the fetus, maturation of the organs, okay, elongation of the fetus in length, okay, and the increase in height. So the first changes in length, and it is most striking during the first 3 months of the fetal period, and the length of the full term fetus is 50 centimeters. Then it changes in weight, okay, most striking during the last 2 months, and the full term fetus is 3.2 kg. Then we have changes in the head size. Okay, so the relative head size is getting smaller. During the 3rd month of pregnancy, the head size is half the crown rump length. During the 5th month, the head size is 1/3 the crown heel length. And at full term, okay, the head size is 1/4 the crown heel length. Then fetal movement. Fetal movement is recognized during the 5th month or week 20. External features, the major or the main external features, okay, sex recognition is possible at week 12, not before week 12. The eyelids remain fused till week 26, and fetus born before week 26 dies. Why? Due to immaturity of the respiratory system and the nervous system. Now, abnormal fetal growth. Abnormal fetal growth either inhibition or stimulation. Then we should know the factors which inhibit fetal growth and the factors which stimulate fetal growth. Okay, so abnormal fetal growth, inhibition, intrauterine growth retardation, and stimulation, overweight baby. So inhibition. What are the causes of intrauterine growth retardation? Number one, fetal malnutrition. Malnutrition of the mother. Number two, smoking. Even passive smoking give birth to underweight fetus. Number three, alcohol. And we know fetal alcohol syndrome giving birth to a small fetus, a small size fetus. Multiple pregnancy, okay, genetic factor. Multiple pregnancy, twins, triplets. And the most important factor for intrauterine growth retardation is placental insufficiency, okay? Due to reduction in the blood supply to the placenta. Then stimulation or overweight baby. Okay, causes of overweight baby. The first cause is diabetic mothers. Okay, diabetic mothers usually give birth to overweight babies. Obesity of the mother. And post-mature baby more than 42 weeks. Have confidence in yourself. Then we'll talk about the fetal membranes. What should you know about fetal membranes? What is the definition of fetal membranes? And what are the fetal membranes? Fetal membranes are the membranes which develop from the zygote but don't form part of the fetus except the yolk sac and the allantois, because the yolk sac forms the gut and the part of the allantois forms the apex of the urinary bladder. So fetal membranes are the structures which develop from the zygote but don't form part of the fetus, with the exception of yolk sac and allantois. So what are the fetal membranes? The fetal membranes are amnion, yolk sac, allantois, umbilical cord, chorion, and placenta. Start by the amnion. Okay, again, this is a photo of the fetal membranes. This is the amniotic cavity, and this is the amniotic membrane, this one. This is the yolk sac. This is the allantois, the diverticulum. This is the connecting stalk or the future umbilical cord. These three layers are the chorion. And this is the placenta. Okay, start by the amnion. Amnion. Okay, regarding the amnion, you have to know three structures. The amnion, or the amniotic membrane, this one, which surrounds the amniotic cavity. This is the amniotic cavity. And this amniotic cavity contains amniotic fluid. Okay, so this membrane is the amnion. This membrane is the amnion. And this is the amniotic cavity. Okay, so let us start by the amnion or the membrane. This is the membrane called amnion, this one. Then we'll talk about the cavity, this one, amniotic cavity. Then we'll talk about the amniotic fluid. Regarding the amnion or the membrane, this membrane is formed of two layers. The first layer, the black one, is the amnioblast. The second layer, the outer one, the brownish one, or the red one, this one, extra-embryonic somatic mesoderm. So the amnion or the amniotic membrane, this one, is formed of two layers, amnioblast and extra-embryonic somatic mesoderm. Then the amniotic cavity, this cavity is bounded by the amnion and the ectoderm. This is the ectoderm. Okay. It contains amniotic fluid. Let us talk about the amniotic fluid, which fills this amniotic cavity. What should you know about the amniotic fluid? What is the origin? What is the volume, functions, and the anomalies? What is the origin of the amniotic fluid? During early development, secretion from the amnioblast. This one. And also during early development, this is the placenta, this is the umbilical cord, transudation from the placental area. But the main source of the amniotic fluid is the kidney of the fetus. So again, origin of the amniotic fluid, secretion from the amnioblast, transudation from the placental area, and number three, kidney of the fetus, which is the main source. That's why if the fetus has only one kidney, we expect to have a small amount of amniotic fluid. Then the volume of amniotic fluid. The normal volume is 1 liter at the end of pregnancy. Then we'll talk about the functions and the anomalies. Now functions of the amniotic fluid. Fluid around the fetus. Okay? So fluid around the fetus, it protects the fetus from external trauma. Number two, okay, the uniform hydrostatic pressure of the amniotic fluid. Okay, it allows fetal movement or fetal exercise. The uniform hydrostatic pressure of the amniotic fluid around the fetus prevents asymmetrical growth. This is asymmetrical growth, okay? One side is larger than the other side. Okay, one side is larger than the other side. So actually, the uniform hydrostatic pressure of the amniotic fluid around the fetus prevents asymmetrical growth. Number four, presence of fluid between the different parts of the body prevents adhesions. Okay? So prevent adhesions between the different parts of the fetus. Okay, presence of fluid around the fetus maintains an even temperature around the fetus. The fetus is drinking all the time. It's drinking amniotic fluid all the time. So actually, amniotic fluid provides the fetus with a fluid to drink. It has two functions during labor. This is the cervical canal, and this is the amniotic membrane. So the first function is formation of a bag. Dilates the cervical canal. When this bag ruptures, it facilitates delivery of the fetus. Functions of the amniotic fluid. Number one, protection. Number two, it allows fetal movement or fetal exercise. It prevents asymmetrical growth. It prevents adhesions between the different parts of the fetus. It maintains an even temperature around the fetus. It provides the fetus with a fluid to drink. And during labor, it has two functions. Dilatation of the cervical canal by a bag of the amnion. And when this bag ruptures, the fluid washes the vagina and facilitates delivery of the fetus. Now, anomalies, abnormalities of the amniotic fluid. Okay, we have two anomalies, oligohydramnios and polyhydramnios. Oligohydramnios, the amniotic fluid is less than 500 milliliters at the end of pregnancy. Polyhydramnios, the excess amniotic fluid. It is more than 2 liters at the end of pregnancy. Okay, what are the causes of oligohydramnios? Okay, number one, placental insufficiency. And number two, absence of one kidney. Okay, renal agenesis. Renal agenesis, absence of one kidney. Okay, polyhydramnios. Polyhydramnios, excess amount of amniotic fluid around the fetus, more than 2 liters at the end of pregnancy. What are the causes? Okay, maternal diabetes. Maternal diabetes usually causes polyhydramnios. Fetal anomalies. Fetal anomalies like anencephaly, because the cerebrospinal fluid is added to the amniotic fluid, and the esophageal atresia, because the fetus doesn't drink the amniotic fluid and have a nice lunch, very expensive lunch, €7. Okay, now the umbilical cord. This is the umbilical cord, and this is the placenta. So what should you know about the umbilical cord? Talk about development, contents, and the anomalies. Okay, talk about development of the umbilical cord. Okay, this is the connecting stalk. This one, connecting stalk. Connecting the amnion with the chorion. Okay, so the umbilical cord develops by elongation of the connecting stalk. It is about 50 centimeters at birth. So actually, the length of the umbilical cord is equal to the length of the full-term fetus. It has a mesenchymal or mesodermal core called Wharton's jelly. It has two ends, one attached to the fetus and one attached to the placenta. One attached to the fetus here and one attached to the placenta. So fetal end attached to the umbilicus, maternal end attached to the center of the placenta. Then we'll talk about the contents of the umbilical cord. Okay, this is the umbilical cord. This is the umbilical cord. This is a section of the umbilical cord. And the yellow substance is the Wharton's jelly. And the black line is the amnion, because it is surrounded by amnion. So number one, umbilical vessels. One umbilical vein and two umbilical arteries. The umbilical vein carries oxygenated blood from the placenta to the fetus. The umbilical arteries carry non-oxygenated blood from the fetus to the placenta. Okay, so umbilical vessels. Then allantois. And this allantois degenerates. Then Vitellian duct. This is the Vitellian duct. Okay, and it also degenerates. This white substance is the extra embryonic siloam, and this is the midgut loop. Midgut loop appears in the umbilical cord between week 6 and week 10. And extra embryonic siloam till week 10. Okay, but at birth, actually, at birth, the umbilical cord contains only the umbilical vessels. Okay, so again, the contents, umbilical vessels, two arteries and one vein. This vein is the left umbilical vein, because the right one degenerates early in development. Okay, then allantois, Vitellian duct, midgut loop, but the midgut loop is present only between week 6 and week 10, and extra embryonic siloam, and at birth, the umbilical cord contains only umbilical vessels. Now, anomalies or abnormalities of the umbilical cord. You can guess, how about the length of the umbilical cord, which is 50 centimeters? So it may be long or short. So long umbilical cord. What is the danger of the long umbilical cord? The long umbilical cord may coil around the neck, okay, causing strangulation and brain ischemia. So this is long umbilical cord. How about short umbilical cord? Short umbilical cord with fetal movement may cause early separation of the placenta. This is the placenta, this is the umbilical cord. So short umbilical cord might cause premature separation of the placenta. So the first anomaly is anomaly in length of the umbilical cord. It may be long, it may be short. The long cord may cause strangulation of the fetus because it might coil around the neck of the fetus. Short umbilical cord might cause premature separation of the placenta. Number two, presence of knots. These knots may be true, like these ones, and very dangerous, okay, or false, okay? True knots may cause or usually cause fetal death, and then abnormal attachment to the placenta. Normally, the umbilical cord is attached to the center of the placenta, but it may be attached to the periphery of the placenta. Now the yolk sac. This is a yolk sac. So after, okay, we know that the yolk sac is lined by endoderm, okay? So after folding, it forms the gut. This is the GI tract, okay? It forms the gut, foregut, midgut, and hindgut. And the endoderm of the yolk sac, it forms the epithelium of the gastrointestinal tract and the respiratory tract. Okay, it also forms the primordial germ cells, which form the gametes, spermatogonia, and oogonia. Then the allantois. This is the allantois, the diverticulum. Okay, it arises from the yolk sac. Okay, it is divided into two parts. Part inside the embryo, and the part outside the embryo. The part inside the embryo, this one, part inside the embryo, the intra-embryonic part. This intra-embryonic part is called the uracus. And this uracus forms two structures. Apex of the urinary bladder, and the distal part degenerates, or obliterates, sorry. The distal part obliterates to form a ligament called the median umbilical ligament. So the intra-embryonic part, the part inside the embryo, will form the apex of the urinary bladder and median umbilical ligament. The extra-embryonic part, which is present in the umbilical cord, degenerates. Now we'll talk about the chorion and the placenta. Okay, this is the chorion. So we'll talk about the layers and the villi and the divisions. The chorion is formed of three layers, okay? The outer layer, this one, is the sensitive trophoblast, this one. The second layer, this one, is the cytotrophoblast. And the third layer, this one, okay, is the extra-embryonic somatic mesoderm, or extra-embryonic mesoderm. Therefore, the chorion is formed of three layers: sensitive trophoblast, cytotrophoblast, extra-embryonic mesoderm. The chorion forms villi, which fix the embryo to the endometrium or to the decidua. We have three types of villi. Primary villi, and the primary villus is formed of cytotrophoblast surrounded by sensitive trophoblast. The secondary villus, okay, a mesodermal core appears in the primary villus. So the secondary villus is formed of a core of mesoderm surrounded by cyto and syncytio trophoblast. Then the tertiary villus, arteriocapillary venous system appears in the villi. Okay, this is the tertiary villus, arteriocapillary venous system appear in the villi. And this tertiary villus has two types. This one is free in the intervillus space, and this one is attached to the decidua. So free villi project into the intervillus space for gas exchange and for everything. And the second one is anchoring villi, which are attached to the decidua. So chorionic villi, three: primary, secondary, tertiary. This is tertiary villus, and the tertiary villus, these are tertiary villi, okay? Arteriocapillary venous system appear in this villi, and the tertiary villi are of two types, okay, free and anchoring. The free villi project into the intervillus space, and the anchoring villi are attached to the decidua. Then we'll talk about the divisions of the chorion. This is the chorion, the white one. Okay? We have two types: chorion frondosum, this one, and the chorion leaf, this one. Chorion frondosum is the part of the chorion facing decidua basalis. This is decidua basalis. Okay? Chorion leaf is the part of the chorion facing decidua capsularis. Look at the villi of chorion frondosum, increase in size and in length. So the villi of chorion frondosum increase in size and in length. Look at the villi of chorion leaf almost completely degenerate or disappear. Okay. Chorion frondosum actually forms the fetal part of the placenta. Chorion frondosum and decidua basalis form the placenta. Okay? Chorion leaf doesn't form anything and it appears smooth. Okay, so again, we have chorion frondosum and chorion leaf. Chorion frondosum is the part facing the decidua basalis. Chorion frondosum is the part, chorion leaf, this one, is the part facing decidua capsularis. Villi of chorion frondosum increase in size and in length. Villi of chorion leaf degenerate and disappear. Chorion frondosum forms the fetal part of the placenta. Now the placenta. This is the placenta. The placenta is formed of two parts, fetal part and the maternal part. The fetal part, this one, is chorion frondosum. The maternal part is decidua basalis. So fetal part, chorion frondosum, maternal part, decidua basalis. Okay? Then fetal membrane, this fetal membrane, placental membrane. This placental membrane is the membrane separating maternal blood from the fetal blood. Okay? So fetal membrane separates fetal blood in these capillaries from maternal blood in the intervillus spaces. Formation. The placental membrane before week 4, before the 4th month, placental membrane before the 4th month is formed of 4 layers. What are the 4 layers? From outside in, syncytio trophoblast, cytotrophoblast, mesoderm, and the endothelium of the blood capillaries. After the 4th month, it's formed only of 2 layers, because 2 layers disappear. So the two layers forming the placental membrane after the 4 months, sensitive trophoblast and the endothelium of the blood capillaries, sensitive trophoblast and the endothelium of the blood capillaries, okay? So part of the mesoderm disappear or degenerate, and the cytotrophoblast disappear or degenerate. These are the tertiary villi. Okay. This is anchoring villus attached to the decidua. Okay. Anchoring villus attached to the decidua. And these are free villi projecting into the intervillous spaces. And this is maternal blood. And this is the placental membrane. So before the 4 months, the placental membrane is formed of 4 layers, sensitive trophoblast, cytotrophoblast, mesoderm, and the endothelium of the blood capillaries. Finally, we talk about the functions of the placenta. Actually, the placenta is a multi-system organ. It is a respiratory system to the fetus. So respiration, exchange of gases, occur across the placental membrane. Nutrition from the maternal blood. Excretion, the waste products from fetal circulation go to the maternal circulation. Okay, the placental membrane, okay, allow passage of antibodies from the mother to the fetus, okay, for immunity. And the placental membrane or the placental membrane act as a barrier against most of the bacteria. And the most important function of the placenta is endocrine function. Okay? Endocrine function secretes several hormones, and these hormones are secreted from the sensitive trophoblast. Of course, number one, estrogen and progesterone. Number two, chorionic gonadotrophin. Chorionic gonadotrophin, it acts like luteinizing hormone, and it is the basis for pregnancy test. Presence of chorionic gonadotrophin in the urine of the mother or in the blood of the mother indicates pregnancy. And actually, chorionic gonadotrophin is very important during early development because it stimulates the growth of the corpus luteum to secrete large amounts of progesterone. The third hormone or the fourth hormone, human placental lactogen. It makes the mother diabetogenic for more access to glucose, okay, to the fetus. Melanin spreading factor, which is responsible for pigmentation of the skin of the mother, especially the areola, okay? And the areola is the area around the nipple. And relaxin, which allows for relaxation of the pelvic ligaments. So again, the placenta is a multi-system organ. Respiration for exchange of gases, nutrition from the maternal blood, excretion, removal of the waste products from the fetal circulation to the maternal circulation, passage of antibodies from the mother, okay, for immunity or for passive immunity. It is a barrier against most of the bacteria, and then it has endocrine function, secretion of several hormones from the sensitive trophoblast. These hormones are estrogen, progesterone, chorionic gonadotrophin, human placental lactogen, melanin spreading factor, and relaxin.